Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Mike Martin. Welcome to another Casio Artist Spotlight. We have a very special guest today. But before we get to that, joining me, as always, 890 miles to my east, Mr. Rich Formidoni. How are you today, Rich?
I'm not too bad, Mike. As always, it's a pleasure to be doing these things with you. Since time has no meaning these days, why don't we make distance have no meaning? I'm sick of 890 miles. I'm going to Tokyo today.
Exactly. Well, I mean, as far as I can see, you're right next to me. It's perfect.
Works for me.
Looking at it, and I remember standing next to you where you took that picture in Tokyo not that long ago.
Yep, so, you were right there.
All right. Well, we have an extremely special guest today. You probably saw him there in that pre-roll. You recognize his music from a number of themes, including Morning Edition, Weekend Edition, Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me, and many other NPR themes. He has his solo music and album we're going to talk about later today. And I guess without further ado, welcome to the broadcast, Mr. BJ Leiderman.
Welcome, BJ.
BJ.
Did we lose him? Aha. Uh-huh.
There he is. All right, BJ.
Is this thing on?
You might have to turn your camera 90 degrees.
Is this thing on? Hi.
Hey, BJ, welcome.
How are you?
Thank you for having me to this. This is scaring the living hell out of me, but cheers.
Oh.
It's just constant comment. Don't worry.
It's always fun. No worries. We're pretty lighthearted and easy to deal with. Our audience, we cannot confirm that for, but we'll do our best to moderate comments.
Well, we really appreciate you spending some time with us, BJ. And we just got, you know, a few questions for you. Actually, a fun little game we might bring in on you as well. We didn't tell you about that part. So we might borrow a theme from one of our favorite shows. So, but I want to talk a little bit about your earliest music experiences. You referenced the Beatles as one of your earliest musical inspirations. Can you tell a little bit about how that influenced you?
Well, I was one of those. I'm a little young. I was born in '56, so I was too young to go to Woodstock, you know, without asking my parents. So that was out. But I was old enough to be sitting on the living room floor in front of the television, you know, when the Beatles hit the other Ed Sullivan show. And I just went, what the hell is that? Something hit me right here. And I have a dear friend, longtime close friend, David Lively, lived in the neighborhood just a couple houses down. He had a drum set and a piano. I had a piano. And so my mom, you know, took us to see Hard Day's Night. And, you know, the girls were screaming in the theater. Yeah, I don't know which Beatle I'm doing from, you know.
Mix them all together. It's fine.
If it goes like this, you know, I could say it like that, but it would be wrong. Well, that's George. And so we were excited. And you got to give it to mom, you know, to drag us into a theater with a bunch of long hairs and screaming girls. And as soon as they started talking, you know, well, who's that, Paulie? Well, he's my grandfather. He's not your grandfather. I've seen your grandfather. Well, he's entitled to two, you know. He's my other one. And we looked at each other and went, what? I don't understand a word they're saying. What are they? And mom went, that's how they talk over there. But ever since then, the next week, David had a Beatle haircut. And I, you know, when I had hair, I did my best. It was sort of like a cross between a Beatle haircut and a Jufra. It was a bejeweled haircut. Because mine went all out like that.
Fantastic.
So we very quickly started learning every Beatle song we could. I was taking piano lessons at the time, but she was trying to get me to read music.
So how old were you? I'm going to interrupt you. How old were you when you started playing piano?
Start asking how old.
Oh, I'm sorry.
How young? How young were you?
I'm going to jump ahead in my little sheet too. Let's see. Virginia Tech, American University. It may say, you know, political activism there, but what I left out was chemistry, which is why I can't remember now what day. So I'm working on my autobiography now. It's going to be this soon, but my friends are going to help me with the dates. I guess I was, do the math, love, 1956, Hard Day's Night, 1964, 65. I was young. We were in sixth grade.
Yeah, maybe 12, 11. Sixth grade.
And we had this little band called the Lively Sound Dimension because he was the drummer. He had the drum set. And on the kick drum in Dayglo Paint, I remember this, Lively Sound Dimension, LSD. Little did I know that a decade or so later. And so we would play those songs with our PA system being Sammy Schwartz's father's 16-millimeter projector off in the shining its light in the corner, and we had the microphone, you know, and we reeled the speaker to the front of the room.
Oh, what fun.
Make do with what you got.
What a life we've lived, man. Starting with a 16-millimeter projector as a PA system and now talking to two people and how many, I don't know, hundreds maybe people watching this?
Yeah.
Scary.
What a time to be alive.
Don't go there.
Uh-oh. Yeah, well, apart from many things. Were any of your other family members musical?
Yes, in fact, both my mom and dad. Dad played trumpet. It's so funny, I have a picture of him. I'm so sorry I didn't send it to you. But in the Korean War, he ran a bar type of thing. He was the talent booker in, you know, the place where the officers would come. And so he played trumpet and he did little skits and he, you know, signed up, I guess, what they would call open mic night now. All the bombs, you know,
that's cool.
Shooting over there. And but it was mom, really. I remember her. Somebody please tell me what that classical piece is.
We will get somebody in the chat to identify it.
anyway, I would sit under the piano, very young. And it goes from sunny type of nice music to dark. And she would narrate this. Da-da-da-da, it's sunny. The sun's out. The flowers are growing and glowing. There's dew on the... And then... And then thunder and lightning and thunder.
Oh, my goodness.
Thunder and lightning and thunder. But I was right there, you know, with my head underneath the keyboard with my, you know, leaning and feeling the vibrations. So they were an influence, and not for nothing, but they had one of the first really huge Victrolas with an 18-inch woofer in it. And the first record, you know, there was, besides Stravinsky and all that stuff, she brought home Limbo Rock one day.
Oh, my goodness.
And I heard bass for the first time. And then my father had a job at a PX type of thing for the military, a department store. And he would just bring home, he brought home Meet the Beatles for me. And I put that on their record player. And as soon as I did, they said, nah, only on your record player, which was, you know, like a box of... you know, dental floss.
Right. With it. Yeah.
But I would, when they weren't home, I would sneak that album back out there. 1, 2, 3, 4. And I mean, it laid me out. It just went, it bypassed this and went straight here.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And it wasn't about, you know, the girls or the whatever, it was the music. And, so it's been disaster ever since.
Well, some might differ on that.
Absolutely.
I have one more childhood question for you. I understand you were once struck by lightning. A, how did that go? And B, can you charge your phone just by holding it? I appear to have struck a nerve.
Well, you know, I have to tell you,
unintended, sorry. It's
the notes that I sent you, there's a third thing that I did not include because we can't go into it here. But it's a very nice side effect of having all that energy.
All right. Fantastic.
Hey, we run a family show here.
I was at day camp, and this storm came up really quickly. They rounded up all the kids from the softball fields into this little shelter type thing with picnic tables that were attached to the concrete flooring with, you know, huge screws. And then they drew the canvas curtains around and we sang camp songs until a double bolt of lightning hit the roof of this structure. And I was wearing shorts, but my exposed buttock, is that how it was? My buttock was sitting on the screw, the little Phillips head screw, and the counselor said, I was knocked out.
Wow.
And I woke up, it must have been 45 minutes later or so, because this is what they all told me later, because the ambulances were coming up the drive. And but what it felt to me like, I only knew it later when I tried to describe it, that cartoon character, Precious Pup, whenever he got a dog treat, you went, and the third one was, he's floating there. That's what I felt. Wow. You know, first that jolt that you get if you mistakenly, you know, slip your finger between the prongs of a plug and a, so I told you it hurt.
Okay.
I don't remember if it hurt. You know, some things hurt more. Broken hearts hurt more.
Yeah. Yes.
Replacement theme music hurts more sometimes. but you got to think, I mean, how many gigawatts? I mean, I could power the car in Back to the Future. What's that device they use in Back to the Future?
The flux capacitor, of course.
I'm a living flux capacitor. But up here, there's nothing anymore. Because all those bumps have hard rewired my, you know, conniption fit up here. So,
well, you don't seem stuck in 1985, so that's a good thing.
Well, thank you very much.
Well, BJ, you're a man of many talents, but the world knows you best as the composer of the themes of many shows that we hear on NPR. How did that relationship start?
Well, I was minding my own business at American University in 1977 or so. And my good friend Skip Peasy, who was then head of engineering department, stuff like that at NPR, called me up and said, there's a meeting I want you to have with someone at NPR, Jim Russell, who was at that time the first original producer of Morning Edition. A little backstory. I used to do jingles, so I had a cassette. Do you have a definition of cassette for some people?
Oh, yeah.
I've got a player right here.
Okay, we need to put on the screen what a cassette. There's a lot of definitions here from the old days. You know, so jingles for car companies. I had a dairy commercial where the cow rhymed with the background singers, who were, by the way, the Starland Vocal Band. Oh, wow. in D.C. They would go, ooh, Marvin May. The cow went, moo, Marvin May. And so I gave these jingles to Skip a year before, not knowing or expecting anything. And then he called me and said he'd given the tape to Jim Russell. And there's a whole backstory I won't get into, but they had a deadline they had to meet. Something went wrong with the original iteration of what was to become Morning Edition, this new morning show. Mm. And back in the day, to get the show, to get the pilot episodes to all of the member stations, they had a duplication room. There, you can find a picture of it somewhere. A couple of master Ampex tape decks, and the room went on, you know, it was like a Kubrick shot. With the walls lined with Ampex, you know, slave mm-hmm. recording machines.
Oh, yeah.
And you line the thing up, hit the button, and then each one of those reels would have to be, you know, shipped. And none of the stations liked the first concept. And they said, we're not going to run this show. Oh, and that's when Jim Russell took the helm. That's when he got this demo from Skip. And Lord love him, he must have... You know, for all the silliness the jingles are, I guess what he got from it was that, boy, this guy can write a melody. So I met with Jim, got the green light to do a demo. It was spring break, I think. I went back to my friend Taco, who later was a guitar player in the band with me. He had a small recording studio with a 4-track reel-to-reel player. And I had a Krumar orchestrator.
Yeah.
The sounds of piano, electric piano, really chintzy strings, a chintzy French horn type of deal, and bass. And I bought a four-way mix box from Radio Shack.
Oh, wow.
Four channels in, and in each channel you could center, left channel, or right channel. And I mixed this thing, and I mixed it to cassette. And I gave it to Skip, he gave it to Jim, and they loved it. Interesting factoid here is that a short while before the show was to go on the air, Jim Russell left to pursue other situations. He actually started up Marketplace, and he is now a consultant. I think his business is The Show Doctor, not too far away from where I am in Nashville. And he walked this thing into... Before he left, he walked the cassette of my demo into a meeting with the new producer, Jay Kernis. And he said, this is Leiderman's theme. We like it. Use it. And, you know, they were hard pressed for time, and Jay liked it. And we had some meetings as to how many different versions and what they should sound like. At one point, Jay couldn't quite describe what he wanted in a short button, a thoughtful button. He said, so imagine as you scribble on a napkin, you're walking through a museum and you stop and you look to your left at the painting on this wall and you react to it. And then you go on a little further and look at that painting on the other wall and you react to that. I wish I'd kept a nap because I got it.
That's pretty cool, actually.
And I don't read music, you know, and I don't speak music, so I guess that's the way I take direction best. Napkins.
That's awesome. So that's just
an interesting visualization.
Taking a look at the chat real quick, Anthony Patterson. Hey, Anthony. One of our other Casio artists. That's the Chopin Raindrop Etude, or Prelude, excuse me.
Anthony, thank you so much. I was staying up nights. Chopin Raindrop
Prelude. Prelude. Not Prelude. Sorry, I have my computer so far away from me today. I can barely read the comments, so I'm absolutely.
I'm going to use that somehow, somewhere in one of these projects I'm currently working on.
Excellent. All right, Rich, so, you got this next one?
Oh, yeah. I'm just seeing another comment here from Leslie. You may not read music, but you sure can play music. Lots of nice words for you here in these chats. So one of my favorite shows while I'm driving, and obviously one of America's favorite NPR shows is Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. Have you ever gotten to also be a panelist or a caller or participate in the show in any other way?
I don't know if I was on twice, but I do remember once, which is something. You know, I remember one of what may have been two appearances.
One out of two ain't bad.
Oh, wait a minute. I remember what the other one was. So they came to Asheville to record, you know, live in front of an audience. I opened the show and warmed up the audience with my piano. Very cool.
Oh, fantastic.
On the stage, the auditorium. I think the first thing I did was, I forgot the name of the segment. Maybe it is. It's not my job. Anyway, the three questions, and I lost miserably. The guy I was playing for, he didn't get, and not only did he not get any prize, I think he had to actually come and work for them for free.
To wash dishes?
For a while. No, I think he was laying trunk cables under the building.
Ah.
Well, let's take a brief pause and take a listen to the Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me theme real quick. So you were saying while we were off camera, the arranger of some of the NPR pieces.
Yes,
is...
I did want to bring Jim Pugh into the picture. He was, when I met him, well, let me go back just a little bit. The first Morning Edition package that I did, it was very innocent in nature. I didn't know the ranges of instruments. I was writing on a synth, and I figured, well, you know, if a cello can play from here to here, flute can play up to here and down. I didn't know. And so I enlisted the help of my friend and great jazz pianist, also a Casio artist, Dan Latt, who helped me notate some of these lead sheets for the cats in the studio. And by the way, Dan Latt plays the opening intro to the original jazz version of Morning Edition, which you never hear. Huh. But I've requested that they play upon my death. if they do a story on the passing of BJ Leiderman, that's what I want them to play. Anyway, so the second time around, every 3 or 5 years, NPR used to send me back in the studio to freshen up the package, to more cuts, more bumpers, and Jay Kurtz invented the word bleeble, which is the repeating. Just repeats for like 2 minutes, so the station can fade in and fade out when they want, you know, to do what they want. Anyway, they said, BJ, this time around, Jim Pugh, BJ Leiderman, BJ Leiderman, Jim Pugh. Jim Pugh has been playing trombone with Steely Dan for the last decade or two. You cannot get better than that in my book. But on top of that, he is an A-list session player when I lived in New York. And if there's an A-plus list arranger, he tried to keep that undercover while he was a player because, you know, he told me there might be a little conflict. But Jim Pugh was the best thing that ever happened to me. I venture to say, actually, that if not for Jim Pugh, we would not be speaking right now. Because an arranger, you know, especially a good arranger, is a writer. And Jim took my, you know, innocent, I would send him my, you know, by then it was 8-track, however many tracks I wanted, but they were demos that I did on my samplers and synths. Send them to him, we'd have some, you know, meetings, some phone stuff, and then we'd meet at, he would send me back synth and sampler versions of his arrangements, and I could tell where he's going with it. And then we'd show up at the studio, some really great RCA studio in New York, the Edison, and he'd have all these players, Richard T., Randy Brecker, Chuck Loeb, all these Steely Dan, you know, later to be Steely Dan.
Big names.
I didn't know any of them. I go, who's that? You know, that's Randy Brecker. Richard T. Oh, yeah, OJs. Oh, okay. And I would sit in the control room eating sushi with, you know, the NPR folk, and Jim would count the four. And I would just kind of cry.
Wow.
Because I knew, I don't know who said it, but whoever said this is absolutely right. Surround yourself with people better than yourself and set them free to do what they do.
That's fantastic.
Because I could not, you know, I micromanaged my ass off my whole life. And when this happened to me, I realized, no, you can find the people, give them the peace, let them do what they do best.
Great advice. Thank you.
That's why we have you on today.
Exactly.
Okay.
So we mentioned Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me. We mentioned that we might have a little bit of a game. We have a twist on one of the famous Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me games, normally called Bluff the Listener. This time we are going to call this one Bluff the Guest. So today's topic is unusual Casio products. And we're going to tell you three stories about some interesting Casio products throughout history, one of which is not true. And if you identify the prize, you will win. Show them, Rich.
A Casio t-shirt much like this one.
Yeah. How come I don't have one of those right now?
You will shortly.
What's the deal? No, we're
no,
done.
He has to. He has to correctly guess the correct one. So,
okay.
All right. So in, you know, since actually before 1957, Casio has been making a lot of different things. We're well known, of course, why we're here today, musical instruments. There's also watches, calculators, projectors, cash registers, and many other things. Most people think Casio's first product is an electric calculator that's about the size of this piano. And because that's what truly launched the company. But it wasn't the very first product. Casio's very first product was, in fact, a ring with a cigarette holder attached to it. It was designed so people could smoke while working on a factory line and still use both hands. So that's option A.
Shall I read option B?
Go ahead, Rich.
One of the other types of products that Casio made are LCD handheld video games. There were literally hundreds of these games and just as many themes, featuring such titles as Lovely Panda, Dandy Cowboy, Hungry Giraffe, and so on. Some of them had little flip-up displays, they took watch batteries, and while they are sought-after collectibles, their gameplay would elicit howls of derisive laughter from anyone born after 1985. One of the rarest of these games is called Turtle Husband. In this game, you play as a zookeeper, and your goal is to successfully get two turtles to mate. This is accomplished by moving the zookeeper up and down to catch a series of male turtles as they cross the screen, and then pressing a button to deliver them to a waiting female turtle.
All right. So that's option B.
I would like that job, actually.
And our last choice, and again, one of these is not true. One of Casio's greatest triumphs was creating the world's first portable electronic calculator. It could actually fit in your pocket. It's an amazing achievement. Casio understandably leaned into their calculator prowess with many variations, all suited for different tasks. There were calculators with synthesizers built in, and synthesizers with calculators built in, and calculator watches, and calculator pachinko machines, and more and more and more. But by far the weirdest was one called the QL10. This was a calculator with a built-in cigarette lighter. It would have been convenient at restaurants so you could figure out your tip while you were lighting your cigarette.
What is the deal with you guys and the cigarettes?
I don't know. So the question is, of those three very interesting stories, which one couldn't possibly be true?
I forgot the first one.
The first one was the ring cigarette holder.
I forgot
holder.
The second one, too.
The second one was the turtle husband. You've got the ring cigarette holder, turtle mating video game.
Did the ring cigarette holder have enough room for the name Casio to be on it? Next.
So that's your choice?
The one that's not true.
That's the one that's not true. Well, to bring you the correct answer, we've brought in an expert who is familiar with Casio product history. Please welcome
us.
Me and Mike. We work here. We're Casio. We'll just tell you. Casio's first product was, in fact, a ring with a cigarette holder.
No!
I put a picture of it up on the screen for everyone to see.
There it is.
That's before it officially became Casio Computer Company. So
our dog is freaking out because he's going, no, don't smoke. That's just a ring.
QL10 calculator with the lighter also, in fact, existed. The correct number was number two. There were definitely some interesting LCD games out there, but animal husbandry was one theme that was probably not considered. It seems some of Casio's early history was dedicated to the timeless art of smoking. Doesn't matter that you've got it wrong. You're still winning our grand prize.
Which is, thank you. I feel like I'm actually on the show.
All right.
How was my Peter Sagal?
There's only, the whole company only has, 28, 29 employees now, right?
The whole thing, worldwide. Yes.
Don't smoke yourself. Who is the brainchild behind the ring cigarette thing?
One of the original Casio brothers. Kashio. The four original brothers that founded the company.
Okay. Is he buried somewhere or he could just go up and smoke?
Oh. <Ba-dum-bum>.
That was strike twice. Sorry about that. Okay, do we get another one?
Oh, no, that's all we had time
that's
to
all
write.
We, yeah, that's all for the obscure trivia. So you sent me a picture right before we went live. So this Rich doesn't know about this. I'm going to put it up on the screen. Dun, dun, dun. You had a recent life event. Here you are on one knee out in a beautiful forest. Tell us about this moment.
Well, it was a February 9th of this year, because I met the young lady who is actually in the room with me. Her name is Melissa. I met her at the White Horse in Black Mountain, this fabulous performance space quite near Asheville. And I was there by myself. I was supposed to be there with a date. but she didn't like Jews or something, so she dumped me. No, she said she had some people coming in the next day, and could we? I gave her a rain check, but I went anyway because friends of mine were playing there, and I am the last person on earth. I mean, this is why I got into band, so I would not have to ask anyone to dance. I wouldn't have to make small talk. I could just be up on stage behind my keyboard, hopefully show them how good a piano player I am or whatever it is. And then, so she was sitting at the bar, not paying any attention to me. And I walked over to her and whispered in her ear, "How would you like to sway with a stranger?" Now, I didn't read that from anything. It wasn't inside a gum wrapper, you know, thing. But she was off of the bar stool before I finished the sentence. And when we embraced to dance, I felt something akin to, you know, lightning go through me. And what I felt was this. It was that this person was telling me that she liked me right then and there. You know, we looked into each other's eyes. I don't want to get all syrupy on you here, but it was, suddenly it was like somebody tapped me on the shoulder and went, "BJ, this feeling you have right now, remember this, because this is the real thing, you know?" And we had a couple of dates, and I said to myself, "BJ, go wherever she goes." Both geographically and whatever, just go where she goes, take a flyer on this. And so 1 year to the day after, we got engaged.
Wow.
How'd I do?
Congratulations. Absolutely congratulations.
Thank you. I mean,
beautiful.
Dog like me. Last chance Texaco, you know?
So let's get back to the music.
Can I talk about this wonderful keyboard that I'm sitting at?
Oh, my goodness.
If you must.
Okay, so I needed a new piano. I had my old workhorse piano was grand. There's nothing wrong with it. As you'll find out in a minute, maybe, if you let me play a song or two, it's a percussion instrument. You beat the hell out of it if you can. And I had worked the other one to death so that there was no spring in in the keys anymore. And not for nothing, it was too heavy. I couldn't carry it myself. And it didn't quite fit in the car right. You know, two people had to carry it anyway. So, and then, yes, the word, I had my head in the sand from the time, you know, in the old days when you thought of Casio as a certain sound. Or shall we say 8-bit-ish and weirdish or whatever. And I called around and asked some friends. One was Dan Latt. I remember seeing that he played a Privia line. I don't know which one he played, but he played the organ on it, and it was fabulous. And then Geary, my friend.
That's right.
In Asheville.
Gary Yelton. Mm-hmm. That's how we got connected.
I called him and said, you know, where should I look? And then we were in COVID, you know, so I couldn't go in really to a store. He said, you know, you should look at the Casio thing. So this thing arrived at my door. It's the Privia SFX B12.
Our model numbers.
Tell me what the number is.
That's a PXS 3000.
Okay, now tell me this. Why? What the hell is it with you companies and you keyboard companies? THX 5004. You're not NASA. It's a keyboard. Put out a keyboard and name it George or Cynthia. Cynthia and George. We'll buy it still.
The Leiderman.
Who's the marketing department that comes up with this stuff?
Mike, are we recording this? Because this needs to be sent directly to Tokyo immediately.
To marketing. I want to see a keyboard. First of all, the thing is, it's gorgeous. I hate to use the word sexy. But when it's off, you don't see anything except a knob, an on button, and a couple of, you know, knobs over here to your left. It's almost like a slim wedge version of the obelisk in 2001.
Yeah.
I could probably stick it in on a mound out there, you know, if I get the declination and inclination right with the sun and the moon, I could probably, you know, end the world, hopefully, just with the moon and sunlight. But then you hit the on button and everything is touch sensitive. The lights are there. You just give it a light touch. So I turned it on and plugged it in. It's got a couple of decent stereo speakers on the back, but I use my, you know, Bose noise canceling headset because I want to hear. My deal is all about piano sound. So I hit the piano, grand stereo piano. Pretty taken aback. I was quite stunned, especially when I looked at the price point. And then I picked it up under one arm and took it to my car. And I said, well, you really got something here, guys. You really do. And, you know, if you want to go... But it's lovely. It's even got the sound, the bloody sound. Well, first of all, I'm going to show you this. Look. I mean, you've taken the care. And, you know, people who play real pianos know that what these things do.
Yep.
The right one, of course, is sustain. The middle one gives you a frosty of any any flavor you want. And I don't want to touch the left one because I'm afraid what that will do.
But that's the self-destruct pedal. Don't do that.
The sustain pedal actually has the sound. If you're on a real piano and you play and then you lift the sustain pedal up, you hear a sound. You actually hear a sound. And this has got that built in. And I understand there are a million permutations of how you can personalize the keyboard.
Yeah.
Since the instruction manual is written in every language except English, I'm going to have to go to the PDF version and search.
Go to the PDF, go to YouTube, find us. When, in fact, Rich and I do a number of webinars on the PXS3000, so there's all kinds of information. Another cool place, BJ, is CasioMusicForums.com. It's a great community site where you can download additional tones, registrations to put in your instrument. So you know people.
I can read Japanese. No, I can't.
Deborah commented a minute ago, sounds amazing. Getting mine this week. Awesome. Thank you, Deborah.
Oh, come on. That's the setup. Deborah, you're going to get it anyway, right?
And Leslie says, next job for Casio, next job for BJ, Casio Marketing.
Welcome aboard.
Wait a minute, Leslie. You're looking at Casio Marketing there. I don't think it was job. However, I did have a neat idea that we might talk about after all this is said and done.
Yeah, I think we're gonna look into that.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Oh man, this is great.
Some great comments. Thank you, everybody, yeah, for being
anybody
here.
Anybody asking for money? Do I owe them?
Not yet.
Well, speaking of money, can I show this thing now?
Oh yes,
absolutely. Yes.
This is me. Album. Yes, album. This is the back of me album.
It is a very good album.
Yeah, it's a very good album, but it only exists on CD. I wasn't hip enough at the time to put it on streaming service. And frankly, I'm actually happy I didn't. Because the only way you can get one of these is to buy it. How do you buy it?
It's right at the bottom of the screen, bjleiderman.com. There we go.
Good. And so, you know, from there you'll see CD Baby or whatever. And while you're on bjleiderman.com, I'd love it if you're interested to fill out that little form, and then I will tell you when all of this mess is over if I'm going to be in your neck of the woods performing, either solo or with a band, in support of your public radio member station. That would be very cool. And then there's one more layer for this. If you want one that's autographed, I'll autograph it for you. If you just get to me through PayPal, send me what you want, and then write in there what you want me to autograph.
Sign. That's very cool.
And I'll do that. Hopefully somewhere upward of $20 will do, because I have to stamping and the packaging and whatever.
You know, we actually had some questions about the album.
While I'm on it, I'm sorry. I can't forget. The backup band for this album is the Randall Bramlett Band.
Yeah. Yes, that's what we were going to ask you about. Yep.
And three of the instrumentals feature Bela Fleck. He was kind enough to let me come to his home studio in Nashville and produce him doing the most outrageous leads over these music beds that I had done a decade or so before. And they just fit wonderfully. They're funny. They're grand. Thank you, Bela.
We were going to ask how it was working with those guys.
Huge question. Well, I'm just trying to get all the names and places right. First of all, we recorded it here in Asheville at Echo Mountain Studio. It's a fabulous studio that's in a church, a converted church. Why is it that churches make the best recording studios? Hmm. Churches and synagogues and mosques.
The acoustics, many of them were built before we were using mics and PA systems. So the acoustics were the first, I mean, other than the beauty.
It was a theoretical question.
I know. I'll shut up now.
I would like to own one of these churches and turn it into, studio. But anyway, it was produced by Eric Serafin, a.k.a. Mixer Man. Go look him up.
Oh, yeah.
Astonished at the...
I know exactly who he...
And it was head engineer by Julian Dreyer, who I adore over there at Echo Mountain. It's a fabulous place in Asheville, which, by the way, is a... Yeah, sorry, I don't want any... Please don't come. It's a great place. It's a great place. No, don't come. Yes, come. When it's safe, come. There'll be so much music. People will be playing in the streets.
I love Asheville.
It is. I kind of came alive here. You know, things changed immensely for me. And I was not, you know, it's not all about woo-woo and whatever crystals. And okay, so yes, we're sitting on... I'm sitting on supposedly the biggest deposit of quartz on the East Coast of the United States. I haven't double, triple checked it out, but I checked it out once. So quartz, we know from being in Cassio Land, vibrates at a certain frequency. So mm-hmm. there may be something to this Asheville vortex stuff, because things have started happening to me, which I call vortex moments. And I've started writing them down, and I've got a large file of events and things that have to do with the same concept or name. One happened this morning after a movie we watched last night. Book I'm reading this morning mentioned the same exact thing within the first two pages of where I started the book. Things that are more than a coincidence, especially mm-hmm. if they're three things that happen within a 24 to 48 hour period. That are very specific. So yes, it's a beautiful place. I'm sorry I went rambling off the deep end. You sure?
No. Now we're getting into the good stuff. You got to send us a copy of that.
Your notes
of your notebook.
I think I'm going to publish it.
Oh, that's great.
You know, on a one thing a day basis. I don't know, or a podcast. I've got so many podcast ideas.
This might even be a Twitter account. I would follow that.
Ooh.
Yeah, I'd have to start a new one because my old one, oh my God, don't even look at my old one.
All right. Everybody listening, watching at home, do not look at BJ Leiderman's Twitter.
Oh, my God.
So I had one or two more questions about the album, if you don't mind.
Sure.
It's full of, it's great stuff. It's full of bluesy rock. There's funky bluegrass. There's songs about romance and heartbreak and a particularly awesome dog.
Oh, and, I love that.
And some really insightful social commentary. And I was wondering, is there any one message that you hope listeners would take away from the album as a whole?
You see, I didn't make that album. I think the album is kind of schizophrenic.
Gotcha. Okay.
But there are groups, like they're categorizations. They're silly songs, walking down the street, you know, about the guy whose girlfriend dumps him, and he walks to the top of what could be the Empire State Building and jumps off in the first verse.
Yeah, that one shook me up a little bit.
Well, it shakes everybody up. They go, PJ, you can't do it. First time I played it to my producer, you can't do this. I said, just listen to the rest of the song. All ends well. And it does. So if you're listening to the album, it's the first song on the album. Do not fret when the guy... No, it's not the first song, but it's in there. Me jumps off. There's the music video is of me. And jumps off the album. John Schnall, his company's called Quality Schnallity. He animated that.
Oh, I was going
to
ask.
Howard Kaufman. You have to know about some of the other animations that you see on BJLeiderman.com concerning the album. They were done by an organization in LA called Exceptional Minds, under the tutelage of creative director, art director, instructor Howard Hoffman, who is a dear friend of mine and who got me to New York City to work as a copywriter to his art director for some of the biggest ad agencies in the world, including Gray, Bozell. There were crazy times. But anyway, what he's doing now is he's teaching youngsters, young adults with autism, to do animation on computers.
Wow.
And since they're in LA, it's kind of a bifurcated thing. Part of it is instruction, and the other half is actually work. They are hired by the big movie studios to do, I don't know if everybody knows what tweening is, you know, animation between this movement, and they fill in, and things like credit rolls and other, you know, effects like that. It's an amazing organization, Exceptional Minds. And so the footage you see accompanying the clips of songs on my album were existing footage that Howie and the young adults put together. And they're wonderful. They're just lighthearted, and they fit the bill.
That's really inspiring.
But the other stuff, I mean, there are three numbers or so that really speak to me, and I hope speak to the people who hear them. Pray was a song that I wrote as I watched in horror as Desert Storm unfolded on time on CNN, complete with graphics and a theme song.
Hmm.
I was just standing in the middle of my living room, and I was aghast. You know, we crossed a new level of weirdness and of, I don't know. And I went right in back into my, you know, home studio. And there's just three verses. There is no bridge. There's no guitar solo. It's the most economical but angry song that I've ever written. And then on the flip side of that is called Praise One Another. And well, I'll tell you more about that later, but it's, I have a certain worldview. And if you're going to say, BJ, what's the bloody worldview? I would say, well, you know, it's a lot like John's And we can leave it at that till the end of the show.
Yeah. Sounds awesome. Good.
Well, everybody does, you know, please go to bjleiderman.com and check out the music that's there. The animations on these videos are amazing. And as Rich said, the one with the dog, absolutely love it. What's your dog's name?
Maisie, right?
Maisie, that's right. That's it.
She passed away a while ago. About a year ago.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear.
The dog is funny. This is the Asheville moment started before I moved to Asheville, because she was a rescue shepherd with floppy ears and a little bit of a limp. And the dog procured me 1 week before my mother accidentally fell and broke her hip, and 2 days later she was dead. So it was almost as if this dog came into my life to help. Maisie was the perfect combination of loving to me, playful, attentive, and I'm going to be between you and danger. Okay. Mm-hmm. You're going to see my ass because my head is looking toward what might be coming at you. So I took her to Asheville with me, and she did all of that for me. And I met Melissa, and when I moved in with Melissa, Maisie moved in with her dog Chance, and then she had this accident falling down the hillside here that day. I mean, you just never know.
Right.
You know, so every day it's kind of like, look at your loved ones and, I mean, don't get macabre about it, but appreciate them with the idea that, you know, Worf said, this is a good day to die. Because it just might be.
Well, it's a beautiful thing that you take these, you know, these important things that happen in your life and around the world and immortalize them the way that you do. It really gives the album gravity that I know people will appreciate if they haven't heard it already. So
thank you.
Recommended listening for sure.
Absolutely.
Thanks so much.
Yeah, and watching the animations tells a wonderful story. Love it.
Thanks.
Where are we? We've been jumping around in
we
our
have.
List.
Have.
Hey, I had a question unrelated, related to music, but I was wondering, what are the technological advances that you think have helped you the most throughout your composing career? What have been the big technological milestones?
I bought the first Macintosh, 1984.
That's a good one.
Couldn't do anything except, you know, Mac Write and Mac Paint. Mm-hmm. Little black and white screen. I didn't even know, when I saw the poster, you know, it's the cute little thing that said hello drawn on it.
Yep.
I said, I don't know what that is, but I'm going to get one. I want one. I got it and set it up. Had one hard floppy disk drive. One. And it had 128K
kilobytes
memory.
Yeah.
Okay, I think I bought the second one. I think I waited till the 512 came. 512K memory. Folks, think about that for a minute. Our computers now have internal memories. Help me out. What?
Gigabytes.
Gigabytes and a terabyte, maybe some of them?
Yep.
Got a USB stick somewhere around here that's 8 gigabytes.
Okay, but I'm talking about, you know, that's built into the machine.
Right.
Correct.
But then MIDI Paint came out. MIDI Paint. It looked like the concept was a player piano roll type of deal. It was the precursor of what we've got now in MIDI representation for most, if not all, digital audio workstations, DAWs, to this day.
Yeah.
And it just stunned me. What? I can play here. You know, chord goes to an interface, which goes to the computer. Oh, I messed up note. I just take the mouse and drag the note down to the right place. Okay. That was amazing. The next iteration of software that allowed non-destructive editing, because I was born in the tape age.
Right.
Okay, 2-inch tape, 24 tracks, got a little section here we need to punch in because the guitar solo, you know, messed his solo up, or I messed my vocal up or whatever, and the engineer is at the button. Okay, I'm going to give you a 5-second roll. 5 seconds, fine. 2 seconds, whatever. I know where I am. and the tape, the song would play, and you know, you'd actually hit the play and record button simultaneously, and then hit the play button again to punch out. If you listen real closely to some of the early Beatles stuff, you can hear some punch ins and punch outs. Yeah. And it was frightening, because if you screwed up, you know, the previous lovely solo was gone, because, you know, and or the next part of the solo, the second or two, was gone. And so that was great. So that's the good side of all this.
Mm-hmm.
And the wonderful side of all this still is that you can still hit the record button and record live with a bunch of cats playing their instruments, counting to four, being a band, or whatever. You know, a tool is a tool. It depends on how you use it.
Right.
I appreciate the quantize feature. Sometimes, you know, I'm a drummer also, but sometimes I sound like a drunk drummer, so I'm not always on the beat. And, you know, it helps pull stuff like that. But God, should I save this for the book?
Give us the exclusive.
There are too many instances where, and I think speaking from a person of my age who has seen the use of this technology in pop culture, all kinds of music. I'm not just calling out a certain type of music. They're all, well, classical hasn't quite, classical is not addicted to this shit yet, I don't think. But what we've got now is a lot of music, to me, too much music. And I can't say that, because the young people creating this music, they know what they want. They know what they like. They know what they like to hear. So let me preface this by saying this could be just an instance of Leiderman is old enough now to be yelling, "Get off my lawn!"
Gotta shake the fist.
What I'm feeling, what I'm missing, is the feeling of songs having raw emotion, power, a groove. Even though you can quantize your drum thing perfectly, I mean, just go back to the Beatles. 1, 2, 3, 4. I mean, that's what that was all about.
Right.
Can't find that a lot these days.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And so there's a phrase that I won't complete, but it has to do with polishing something. And
understood.
So there's a lot of beautiful, beautiful, gorgeous sounding stuff out there. And then there's another argument that makes me want to blow my brains out. The beautiful, you know, even though the stuff sounds beautiful, people are okay to listen to it out of their iPhone speakers or shitty earbuds. Yes, I'm mad, Chance. Yosemite?
Oh, I agree.
That drives us nuts, too.
I couldn't agree more. Yep.
Why should I bring my back? You know, producing stuff that sounds great and working with Mixer Man, you know, Eric and the folks at Echo Mountain and these great players. And first of all, people, you know, by the way, got to do video, because, of course, no, you can't just listen to music. I have some. I'm sorry. I really am. Get off my lawn. Get off my lawn. But I guess, by the way, this album is the only album I'm going to make. This is one and out. There's not going to be a number two, but I may record some more songs. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to find an Edison wire recorder. You know, the most god awful thing I can record on. And I'm going to go into a tunnel somewhere. You know, Nashville is a tunnel where the trains come over into the mm-hmm. train station type of thing. And I'm going to wait till the trains are coming. And, you know, we're going to get to set up the drums, one mic, and the mic will be this little realistic thing I got from Radio Shack in 1968, you know, and I'm going to hang it from the top of the tunnel. I'm going to swing it, and it's going to knock against the wall. We're going to count to four. We're going to put, and I'm going to put that out 8-bit. I'm going to compress the hell out of it, make the sounding piece of, and put it out.
And wait for the check to roll in.
Oh, that's another argument. Don't make me go there. Stream this. Oh, that's a great title for an album, but since I'm not going to make another one. anybody say I owe them money or anything yet? Or did they?
Actually, yes. Good friend Joe earlier said that, yes, he does owe me money. So, yes.
Joe just bought the form on bjleiderman.com where you can buy this album if you want. I'll autograph it for you, and we'll just call it even. Give you much more than I owe you.
He also just mentioned that he knows a guy who recorded an album on a wax cylinder a few years ago.
There you go. Okay, I'll record one track, one channel, left channel on the wax cylinder and the right channel on an Edison wire recorder.
Right.
Or let's see, if Eric Serafin is listening now, Eric, can we record on the wire recorder? Or maybe a couple of them, you know, two or three tracks, and mix them to the wax cylinder. Can we do that? And then put it all out on a piano roll. And that's the only way you can hear it, is buy yourself a bloody, you know, play a piano and put the roll on there. And then you have knitting needles you put in your ears so you can, you know, mess with your hearing so you won't hear anything. And then just play the piano.
You know, it's a niche market, but I think it could work.
Hey, I've managed to stay away from politics and COVID. Give me 10 points. We're an hour into this interview.
We are.
And I've stayed, you know.
So nicely done. You just mentioned playing the piano. Mm. So you know what?
All right.
How about, first, let me thank you on behalf of everybody here at Casio. I mean, really loved spending this time with you. Perhaps you could play us out.
The honor's mine. Thank you.
All right, thank you, BJ.
Thank you, everybody.
And everybody, please go to bjleiderman.com. I'll put it at the bottom of the screen.
I won't be hyped if you don't. Believe me, I won't be hyped. when you asked me, you know, what did the album represent something to me, the last song on the album is called Praise One Another. The lyrics, I'm not playing that now, but the lyrics go, praise one another, worship one another, love one another, and the whole round world will be fine. And, you know, as a country, as a planet, I think we could be doing better in our evolutionary process. And John Lennon had this all wrapped up way back when he put out what I think is the best prayer for the possibility of human survival on the planet. And I think he saw it the same way I do, and that is, you back up from the Earth, you back up and you back up until you're an astronaut seeing the Earth rise over the moon, that famous shot, or just the shot of the Earth surrounded by space. And you look at that and you can't help but think that, you know, there are enough divisions on this planet that we live with anyway. Geographical divisions, you know, borders, language divisions, race divisions. And so I guess my deal is, let's not create any more artificial, man-made, created groups that, while they may serve to do good, also serve to separate us one from another yet again. So I'm going to close with, do my best here. It's not 9 o'clock yet, so we'll see what we get. Piano glasses. Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. gone must own the sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no country. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. No religion to. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us in a world we'll live as one. Imagine no possessions. Wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. The brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people sharing all the world. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us. And the world will live as one. And everybody out there sing out loud. Very good. And the world would live as well. Thank you. Oh, we got sound effects. Boy, it sounds nice on this. Thank you very much, everybody. It's been fun. And one thing you could do, never mind the, besides going to the website, ask your public radio member station, hey, when are you having BJ? Because I will come and play with your orchestra, play the NPR,
love it.
NPR theme medley of all the shows that I've done. It's quite exciting. And play with a rock band, and we have a dance party, whatever they want. I can come and do. We'll have fun. And I'd like to meet you face to face. But thanks for joining us here.
Thank you, BJ. Everybody, thanks, reach BJ. Out to NPR. Go to BJ's website. On behalf of everyone again at Casio, thank you, BJ. And if you like this video, please like, subscribe, share, and we'll see you again on the next Casio Artist Spotlight. I'm Mike Martin.
Peace and love.
Thanks for watching. Peace and love.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.